jamo jamo hari hari Yeah, I'm all. Yeah. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Krishna, Krishna Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna.
It is such an integral part of our philosophy, chanting. We often sing the bhajan, Harinam Eva Kevalam, which actually not only is it an integral part of our philosophy, but the meaning of that bhajan is the holy name of Sri Hari is everything. So not only is it a part of our philosophy, but it's meant to be everything for a practitioner of Krishna consciousness. And the whole process of advancing in Krishna consciousness is making progress along the path of chanting to the platform of pure chanting. In fact, just today, I guess, today I was having a conversation with two people about this. But if I'm to speak about the conversation with two people, I might have to explain why I was having this conversation. Because it was in a gym. And you might be wondering, what am I doing in a gym? So so maybe I should briefly explain why I was in the gym and why I was having a conversation with these two people in the gym. Anyways, I'm in the gym because I was instructed by the doctor that I have to exercise because of my current health condition. And I took advantage of being in one place for a while to do the type of cardio exercises which I need to do. And I was able to get access to a gym right nearby where I'm staying. I spoke to the owner, and I explained to him my situation. I'm only visiting for a few weeks. I need to do some cardio exercises for a while. And he gave me the key and said, you can come anytime you want. It's yours. And so I usually go every morning very early when there's nobody there, or hardly anybody there. And I'm exercising more than I have, I think, for the last 40 years. And but there were some other people there also. And yesterday there was, it started yesterday, the conversation, two men who were, started to come around the same time that I came. They came over to me and they were kind of suspicious of me. I mean, I'm dressed in, not in a dhoti, obviously. I can't. One of them said, you know, kind of like, can't remember how he struck up a conversation with me, but basically he said, what's your name, or something like that. And I just told him what my name was, and he said, we've been watching you. And they said something like, you look like you don't belong in here. And I was waiting to say, you know, get an explanation of what does that mean. Like, I know I'm not a muscle builder, I'm not a bodybuilder, you know, and I'm not building muscles. And they said, he said, actually, he said, you look too peaceful. And he said, you know, can you tell us, you know, like, basically, he said, you know, Why do you look so peaceful? Usually, I look peaceful because as soon as I go on the exercise machines, I immediately, well, first the first machine I do, I listen to Bada Hari Das, well, chanting Kirtan, and then when I go on the other machine, I listen to Prabhupada and lecture. So I couldn't tell him that's why I was peaceful. But they started really. I was shocked because these men were probably my age, maybe a little bit older than me. I know one of them is a few years older than me. I don't know the other one. But what they really wanted to know is how to become peaceful. And if you looked at these two people, you would have never expected a question like that. I mean, it's the last thing I expected from these two guys when they came up to me. It's like, you know, how to be peaceful. So I say yesterday because the conversation started yesterday and it turned into like a 45-minute Sunday feast lecture because they didn't want to go away. And they said they were coming back again today and they asked me, you know, can we continue today? So today we got into the chanting part. But yesterday... first thing I told him, I said, well, I'm a member of the Hare Krishna movement. He said, wow, yeah, I heard of that before. And that just took off from that point. You know, they wanted to know all about what I do and everything about me. And then they started getting into some really relevant questions about, you know, peace and what is the method. I told them about meditation and explained to them what meditation is, and they want to know what type of meditation. I said, well, I chant a mantra, and I explained to them that by chanting this mantra that one can gradually begin to experience within. I don't explain to them how it's a sort of cultivation. And then this morning when they were asking questions, they say, you know, they were asking like, wow, they like, how long, you know, I told them I had been doing it for over 40 years. And this morning they started to try to ask questions like, you know, how many people can continue to do with it for as long as you do? Just they say, do some of the people actually find it difficult to continue doing this? I also told them I was celibate, which was really, I mean, they really took off on that one. And they wanted to know how to do it. and you know, because he one of them really related to, you know, like, you know, I can see how it really, you know, can cause a lot of problems. If but anyways, they were asking about to some people give it up, and how many actually stay, continue, like, you know, you said you chant at least 2 hours every day, and you've been doing it over 40 years. You know, there must be something. You know, is there, what keeps you going, and what keeps people going to continue doing it for 40 years? And I started to explain to them that, you know, that sometimes people come, as Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, that sometimes people come for relief, for distress. And those who are inquisitive, those who are wise, those who are in need of money, and those who are looking for relief from distress. And I explained how sometimes people come looking for relief from distress, and when they find relief from distress, then they think, oh, now that I'm relieved from distress, that I can try it again, everything I was doing before. And one of the gentlemen was really, he related to that because he was going through some stressful situation, and he says, well, you know, how to take it to some higher platform beyond relief from distress? And I said, wow, that's a good question. It's a really good question. And I found myself, you know, discussing, essentially, you know, with these two men who were both riding stationary bicycles while they were talking to me. And I was standing in front of them, and about what is the goal of chanting. And in fact, they're waiting for part three tomorrow morning, so I have to get back. Because they said they're going to be there at, I think, at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning. And they want part three. And this is what, of course, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta is speaking about here. What is the actual goal of chanting? And as we know, the goal of chanting is service. And the goal of chanting is not relief from distress. As a matter of fact, not this quote, there's another quote, it's an interesting quote. I think I just thought of it. I was reading this one yesterday. Excuse me one second. And it was under the section of chanting the holy name. Yes. Sorry, I'll find it. That's not it. But I want to read it. This is exactly on this point. I can't find it. I'm sorry. I was reading it sometime today, but It's not coming, not manifesting to me right now. Oh, it is, just manifested. He says, pure devotees do not chant the Lord's names to counteract sinful reactions, accumulate piety, attain heavenly pleasures, to mitigate famine, devastating epidemics, social unrest, disease, civil strife, or to obtain wealth or an earthly kingdom. Since the Lord is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, to ask Him to fulfill our wishes is to treat Him as our servant. This is an offense. Therefore, calling the Lord's names for any reason other than to attain His devotional service is useless. Jesus Christ told us not to take the Lord's name in vain. However, this does not mean we do not need to always chant the Lord's names while sleeping, awake, eating, or enjoying happiness. To chant the Lord's name, begging for His service, is not a useless activity. It is our only duty. But to make a show of chanting for some other purpose, in other words, to fulfill our own desires, is useless. We should not take to the chanting of the Lord's names uselessly. We should not chant to attain religiosity, economic development, sense gratification, or liberation. Instead, we should always chant to attain the Lord's service. So, interesting quote. In other words, it almost, of course, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta uses the word useless. We know there are many quotes that even once chanting the holy name, one can immediately eradicate more sinful reactions that one can accumulate in millions of lives. Of course, it means chanting the holy name without offense. Or even chanting the name, you know, once, there was always some benefit from chanting the holy name of the Lord. But the point that he's making, and by using the word useless, is that the real fruit of chanting the holy name of the Lord, real fruit which it can give, Prabhupada would oftentimes quote the verse about Namachintamani Krishna Chaitanya Rasa Vigraha, that the holy name is transcendental and can give all spiritual benedictions because it is non-different from Krishna. It's completely free from all material contamination, and Krishna's name and Krishna himself, they're non-different. So the holy name of the Lord can give all kinds of spiritual benedictions, but the devotee is not interested in any material benediction. The ultimate spiritual benediction for a devotee, which not only mitigates all suffering, but not only fulfills all other material goals in life, is to obtain service to Krishna. Once having attained service to Krishna, in fact, Bhagavatam states, even rendering service to Krishna for a moment is so beneficial that anyone who even for one moment renders service to Krishna with the proper consciousness. Srila Narada Muni tells Vyasadeva that, my dear Vyas, even though a devotee of Lord Krishna may sometimes fall down somehow or other, he may fall from the path of devotional service, but if he's once rendered Krishna, service to Krishna with a pure motive, even once sincerely, he will never become a fruitive worker again, because anyone who has once relished a taste of Krishna's service will never forget that ecstasy again and again. And because he'll never forget that ecstasy of the service, of the fulfillment, of having the opportunity to render some service to Krishna with the mentality of pleasing him, that moment of the experience of that service, actually Krishna will never forget. He will never forget it. And if Krishna never forgets that service, it means he can never forget the person who rendered that service. And because he can never forget the person who rendered that service, he will always arrange for that person how to bring him closer to him. So even if a devotee forgets, if he falls down from the path, if even one moment he's rendered some sincere service, he'll never be lost. Whereas the verse previous to that explains that even if he perfects all other religious duties, perfects all kinds of his social duties, fulfills all of his otherworldly obligations perfectly, he doesn't gain anything. So that, in that sense, is what Srila Bhaktisiddhanta is using the word useless. Useless in the sense, because what is actually obtained, what is gained, if one hasn't actually come in contact with the permanent solution, which is our constitutional nature as eternal servants of Krishna. And then by being engaged in Krishna's service and having obtained the opportunity to render service, and then what to speak of, coming to the platform of pure devotional service, the devotee is so fully satisfied in the service itself that he doesn't think of anything else. And this is what actually brings about a peaceful state of Krishna consciousness, is that a devotee doesn't even have to think of his own happiness. Imagine how peaceful that is when you don't even have to think of your own happiness. As Krishna says, one who is not connected to the Supreme can have neither a controlled mind nor steady intelligence, without which there's no possibility of peace. How can there be any happiness without peace? And Krishna says, one who's not connected to the Supreme cannot have these things. But when the connection is there, a devotee feels so satisfied by the service itself that he doesn't have to even think of his own happiness, because the service is so satisfying. And therefore we see some examples of pure devotees when we read Srimad Bhagavatam, when we read about the devotees who are actually experiencing, relishing the taste of service to Krishna. We see by their own example that they don't even think of their own happiness. All they think of is Krishna's happiness. And sometimes people think, what is that? People can't understand. What is that phenomena? Are you? Is there something wrong with you? It's a mystery. It's a mystery. But if we actually want to get the key to unlock the mystery, because devotional service will always remain a mystery, unfortunately, it will always remain a complete mystery. Krishna says, only by undivided devotional service can you know me as I am standing before you. Only then can you enter the mysteries of understanding me. Only by undivided devotional service. He says that to Arjuna. Otherwise, it's a mystery. We start to think, well, you know, I've done this, you know, or, you know, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta says, and there's something very else, very interesting in this connection. I was reading this the other day. It's a short quote. He was saying that we should not think that we're doing Krishna a favor by chanting his name. He said, he says, we often think we're doing the Lord a favor by offering him prayers, that we could have engaged in some other activity than chanting the Lord's name. You know, I could have done something else. Look, I'm doing this for you. I'm just doing a favor for you. He said, such a mentality is an example of a lack of tolerance. He said, we need someone to protect us from such a mentality, someone to help us become lower than the straw on the street. We certainly need to take shelter of a person who will deliver us from sinful motives. Srila Narottam Thakur says, Lord Krishna does not reject those who worship him under the shelter of a spiritual master. In other words, we need to have to come under the shelter of proper spiritual guidance of somebody who actually puts things into proper perspective for us. And of course, that's what Srila Prabhupada did for each and every one of us. He always established what is the goal. so that we don't become sidetracked and start thinking that, yes, the goal of chanting Hare Krishna is to have good health. The goal of chanting Hare Krishna is to become free from famine, disease, for social unrest, civil unrest, you know, whenever there's any disturbances. You know, this is not the goal of chanting. This is a material motive, and therefore on that basis, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta says, until we actually understand that the chanting is meant to give us service, because the service itself will mitigate. That's one of the byproducts of devotional service. It mitigates, it relieves one from material distress. It's a byproduct, but it's not the goal. So that byproduct is automatically achieved without any extraneous effort. One doesn't have to look for mitigation from distress if he simply looks for service. And because Krishna is a person, and because Krishna understands our motives, he understands our heart, he understands everything that we're holding back, he knows exactly why we're doing something. And when he sees that when a person is really willing to undergo some personal, maybe even some inconvenience to do something for his pleasure, which usually is what it comes down to, because devotional service it's an inconvenience. It's an inconvenience to do something for somebody, exclusively for somebody else, and not have to think about myself. That's an inconvenience. It's more convenient to think about myself. It's more expedient, we think. Think about myself, and then if I think about myself first, then when I'm taken care of, I can do something for Krishna. No. Krishna knows that. He knows. Are you thinking him first? So obviously we won't experience that. We won't unlock the mystery. We won't experience what Krishna wants to give to those who serve him with pure motives. Some other form of reciprocation will be there, but we won't experience bhakti, and we won't experience what pure devotional service is, and therefore it will always remain a mystery. Therefore, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta has established that this is our motive in chanting Hare Krishna. And I didn't get into all these details when I spoke to the gentleman in the gym this morning. They weren't quite ready for that part of it. Maybe that will be part three or part four, I don't know. Depends on the line of questions they continue to ask me when they meet me there tomorrow morning. But essentially, that the way that we can remain fixed on the goal and remain steady in the performance of chanting Hare Krishna and not give it up and understand that, yes, the goal of participating in our Krishna consciousness movement and the goal of chanting the holy name is ultimately to come to the platform of pure chanting. And we should not become discouraged if it's not there. Because even if we're not pure, even the desire to be pure, Krishna accepts as pure. Krishna accepts that. He's bhavagrahi. He accepts the essence of a devotee's attitude. And he knows. He knows that even if we're not pure, but if we have a desire to be pure, that means I want to become pure. I want to ask the right questions, how to become pure in heart. I want to become free from material motivations. I don't want to avoid those things which inconvenience me because it reminds me too much of performing the austerities of devotional service. And I'd rather be more comfortable in my own, you know, comfort zone. Devotional service actually means how to get out of our comfort zone, because the comfort zone is not real comfort, and go beyond it and look for real comfort, which Krishna is willing to give. And all he asks, simply chant. Simply chant, that's all. But chant, as Prabhupada says in one commentary, Janmaishvaya Shuta Shabi Edamana Madapoman. That verse where Queen Kunti is praying, "My Lord, your lordship can only be approached by those who are material exhausters, those who are on the path of material progress, trying to approach you with respectable parentage, bodily beauty, great opulence, high education. They can't approach you with sincere feelings." And Prabhupada said that a materially satisfied person can't feelingly call out Krishna's name. He can't feelingly call it out. He can't call it out because he's not depending on Krishna's name. He's depending upon his comforts. But then when those comforts aren't there, then is he going to go back to looking for those temporary external comforts, or is he going to feelingly call out, "Hey Govinda, hey Govinda, I have no one but you." As Draupadi, when she was being disrobed, "I have nobody but you." And there's a story, you know, that goes in that connection, that Draupadi once asked Krishna, he said, "Why does it took so long for you to come and to protect?" And Krishna told her, he said, "Actually, first you were thinking that your husbands would protect you. And when you looked at your husbands, first you were thinking that Bhishma would protect you because he was the senior in the assembly. And Bhishma was compromised. He couldn't do anything. And then you were thinking that your husbands will protect you. But look at your husbands. They couldn't protect you either. So you were thinking they should protect you, but they couldn't protect you. And then you held your sari, thinking you could protect yourself. What could I do? It's only when you let go and said, 'Hey Govinda, I have nobody else. That's it. I run out.' I immediately came and offered you protection." So this is how a devotee actually has to call out Krishna's name. "Hey Govinda, I have nobody else. Everything else is temporary. It can't give me permanent shelter. Only you can give. And you're so kind that you've given your shelter, your personal shelter, in your name." Lord Chaitanya has instructed that your holy name alone can render all benedictions to the living beings, and therefore you have hundreds and millions of names like Krishna and Govinda. In these transcendental names you have invested all your transcendental potencies, and there are no hard and fast rules for chanting these names. Oh my Lord, out of your kindness you've made yourself so easily accessible by these names. But I'm so unfortunate. I have no attraction for them." This is Krishna consciousness. This is what Srila Prabhupada came to teach us, to give us. And this is what Srila Prabhupada, as the protector, the guardian of devotional service, what he so carefully did to help his followers, to steer them on the right path so they wouldn't get lost and get caught up in forgetfulness of what is the goal. And therefore, as Srila Bhakti Siddhanta says here, he says, we certainly need to take shelter of a person who will deliver us from the improper motives and set us on the right path. How to chant Hare Krishna in this life, and next life, and to go on chanting the holy name of the Lord, and to achieve the goal of chanting, the ultimate goal of chanting. We need to know these very simple, basic teachings which Lord Chaitanya himself came to give and Srila Prabhupada came to give us. And Srila Bhakti Siddhanta is also given us very nicely in these few quotes that I've given here. So at 7:30, I know we're accustomed to finishing by this time. Does anybody have any questions or comments they'd like to ask or make? Yes?
If someone's chanting there's like the 26 qualities of a devotee, and they know they don't have it.
Mm-hmm.
but they chant, please Krishna, somehow arrange that these things that I learn, that I realize these things. Is that all right?
Yes. Yes, these things are okay. As we read, that it is not useless chanting, to chant to become a devotee. And these 26 qualities of devotee is what actually embodies the life of a devotee. And therefore, to pray for these qualities will simply help us to become more instrumental in being able to serve Krishna's desires. Otherwise, if we don't develop these qualities, of course, there is a, Prabhupada would oftentimes quote a verse, yasyasti bhaktir bhagavatya kinchana savai gunais tatra samasate sura harava bhaktasya mahadguto madona tenasati davato bihi. This verse says, all the good qualities of the demigods will automatically become manifest in that person who engages in unalloyed devotional service to the Supreme Lord Vasudeva. On the other hand, a non-devotee who is driven by mental speculation cannot manifest any good qualities. So, Prabhupada would oftentimes quote that verse, that devotional service in of itself can actually restore the living being to his natural state, which is to have all of these good qualities. So, that is the power of devotional service. Is that it's these good qualities will automatically manifest themselves in a person who actually serves purely. But to have a desire to develop these qualities so that one can become a better servant of Krishna is not wrong also.
Does the service come first, or do the qualities, I mean, everything is always prerequisite, prefaced with, if one simply chants and then there's purity, then
yes.
If one has undivided or unalloyed devotional service, these are so important, because so many times one finds oneself serving, but you can feel the taint. You can feel what your mind is thinking. Will I be recognized? Will someone know? You know, my left hand does know what my right hand is doing, type of thing. I am, you know, not doing this purely. How are we to come to...
Well, the important part to understand is that even if we are impure, that Krishna's name is pavitram, completely pure. And if we chant, even with an impure heart, we chant Krishna's name, then Krishna is the agent who purifies. And therefore, it's understood we're impure. And a sincere person who looks within his own heart and sees his own purities, he's automatically qualified to chant. Just by seeing our own impurities is an asset, because then we know what to ask Krishna for. We know what our impurities are, and we can't purify ourselves. Only Krishna can purify us. So therefore, yes, the goal is to chant purely, but even though we see the impurities, if we simply chant with a desire to become free from those impurities, that's what actually brings us to the pure platform of chanting.
After chanting and asking for these benedictions, so to speak, should one then see that everything that is all relationships, all interactions after that are simply Krishna? One should look for Krishna's hand in everything.
Yes.
As a means by which these impurities will be...
We'll actually begin to feel Krishna's presence more and more in our life, if that's what you're asking. Yes, you begin to see how Krishna is very instrumental to eradicating the attachments from within our heart. It's very instrumental. But the point is how to be able to go on serving Krishna as the verse which is oftentimes stated, Tate Nukam Pam Susha Mikshamano, Bhujani Evat Mikritam Vipakam, that one who seeks your compassion and goes on tolerating all kinds of adverse activities which he sees which is due to the karma of his own past misdeeds, tolerates them, who goes on serving Krishna and glorifying Krishna with his body, mind, and words, then mukta padesa dayabak, he becomes a bona fide candidate for liberation, freedom from all material contamination, and becomes a qualified candidate for pure devotional service. So, in other words, Krishna will put his devotee, like look what the Pandavas went through. I'm reading Mahabharata right now. You know, I'm going back and I've just been reading this whole section about what the Pandavas are going through at the hands of Duryodhana and Dhritarashtra. And I was just listening to a lecture on the exercise machine yesterday. Prabhupada was talking about Dhritarashtra, what he was doing to the Pandavas. And yet the Pandavas were always fully dependent on the mercy of the Lord. They never made any effort, fully dependent on the mercy of the Lord for everything. And therefore, they were put through great tribulation, put in a house of lack, the tent to kill them, to burn them, to kill them all. And, you know, the poison was just given to them, and so many other attempts were given to take their lives away. But the result is that they never gave up service. They never gave up service. So Krishna will sometimes put his devotee in a situation it's very difficult. It's very difficult. And that test is there to help us to become more dependent on Krishna. So much so that even Queen Kunti, she prays. She says, Vipatushantu takshashrat tatra tatra jagad guru. She says, let those calamities happen to me again and again, so that I can see you again and again. Because when those calamities happen to me, I always think of you. I always depend on you. So, yes, we have to see those calamities and those difficulties as divine intervention in our life. Krishna's hand, he loves us. He wants to bring us to him. If we take it that way, he's very kindly doing this to help me to become more dependent upon him, then we'll actually feel the effect of chanting. And we'll experience more Krishna's presence in our life. We oftentimes also quote the verse from the 11th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam that states, Bhakti Pareshana Bhava Varaktiya Anyaisha Chaisha Trika Eka Kala, that devotion, direct experience of the Lord, and detachment from material things. These three things come for a person who's actually engaged in devotional service. Just as pleasure, nourishment, and relief from hunger comes with each bite, simultaneously, increasingly, for a person who's eating. So this verse actually says that to the degree that we're engaging in devotional service, we begin to experience the direct presence of the Lord more and more in our life. We begin to experience our devotion increasing. And we see that the things that were the cause of so much disturbances are not so significant anymore. We become more detached from them. That's all due to Krishna's presence in our life. It can't happen any other way. It's not due by our own efforts alone. So certainly, becoming more conscious of Krishna's presence, his hand, that's what every devotee should be looking for in their life. But they have to be careful not to misinterpret and think that, oh yes, Krishna gave me this, or Krishna's... Sometimes people will... They'll use Krishna, as Srila Bhakti Siddhanta says, for their own service. Yes, Krishna's giving me this, and making me happy, and I'll use it, and I'll take advantage of it. But no, Krishna's giving it to me to serve him. To serve him, not for me to enjoy. Krishna gives us what we need to serve him. Ananyas chintayatomam yejana pashante tesham nitya buyukdanam yoga kshema vyaham yaham. This verse actually means, Srila Baladeva Vijayabhushan has given a commentary to this verse. And he says that this verse means that for those who are always meditating on Krishna, endeavoring to serve him, Krishna carries what they lack and preserves what they have. And Srila Baladeva Vijayabhushan says, he says, Krishna gives them what they need to serve. And not only does Krishna give them what they need to serve, but Krishna, Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says this, he says that Krishna never takes the maintenance of his devotee as a burden. He says it's more like a lover carrying his lover, his beloved. He said that in the same way, we should never think that we're burdening Krishna by depending on him. Oh, I don't want to burden Krishna. For a devotee who's exclusively dependent, Krishna relishes giving the devotee what he needs so that he can go on serving him. So the point is to serve him, not to become comfortable, but to serve. Service is always first. Always first. And then what happens? One comes closer to Krishna. One makes advancement. He keeps on coming closer and closer. And ultimately Krishna gives him pure devotional service. Yes.
I was reading the translation of Bhagavad Gita by Srila Vishnavata Chakravarti, and he says in this translation, he said that those who engage, Krishna says that those who engage in the chanting of the holy name, those who engage in my devotional service, not to worry, even if they're not properly situated, I will personally come and instruct them in devotional service. Yeah. So through the spiritual master, through Srila Prabhupada, and the devotee, Krishna comes and he gives instructions to bring you up to that level, because spiritual life is, as we know, is association is 80% of your spiritual life. So by staying in that association, it brings you to a level in Krishna conscious of balance. And those devotees are there to assist you to get to that point of pure love for Krishna.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Prabhupada actually, in one important conversation, Prabhupada elaborated on that and explained that what it means is that Krishna, even if a devotee is not properly situated, Krishna will instruct him by bringing him to a Vaishnava who can instruct him. Yes.
Maharaj, you said that the goal of chanting is service, but you also said that service may be considered sometimes inconvenient.
Service can be what now?
The devotional service may sometimes be inconvenient.
Considered as an inconvenience, yes.
So how can we stop from looking at devotional service as an inconvenience, and how can we stop from engaging in devotional service just because it gives you relief of distress?
Yeah. Well, it actually means changing our motive. You know, and changing the motive, because actually, essentially, advancement in devotional service is actually simply means changing our motives, essentially. Because pure love is nitya siddha krishna prema saju kapunoi, as stated in Chaitanya Charitamrita. Pure love is eternally situated in the heart of every living being. It doesn't come from any other source. And when the living entity hears about Krishna, and that love is brought out, it's awakened. So the only way to change motive is to associate with those who are pure. There's no other way. There's just simply no other way. Therefore, we associate with Krishna's name, who is always completely pure. We hear the glories of Krishna's name from those who present the glories of Krishna's name for the purpose of bringing us to the platform of purity. We hear Srimad Bhagavatam from those whose motives is to actually bring us to the platform of purification. There is no other way to become purified of impure motives than to associate with that which is pure. There's just no other way. By our own efforts alone, we can't do it. We're dependent. By nature, a living being is dependent. Therefore, even those who try to become liberated by their own efforts alone, Chaitanya Charitamrita says, they're kami, they're still impure. Krishna bhakti nishkama ata yeva shanta bhukti mukti siddhi kami sakali yashanta. Those who want enjoyment, material enjoyment, those who want mukti, relief from suffering, those who want mystic yoga perfections, they're still kami. They're filled with lusty desires because they're thinking, I want freedom from suffering. I want freedom from suffering. I don't want to suffer. So persons may begin to engage in very severe austerities and penances to become freed from suffering. But what does Lord Brahma say? They fall down from that position because they haven't connected to Krishna's lotus feet. They'll fall down. And how did they get connected to lotus feet, Krishna's lotus feet? It's only through service and associating with those who actually always remind us about the importance of devotional service. And there's just simply no other way to purify the impure motives within our heart than to associate with that which is pure. Prabhupada says, just like if you put an iron rod into fire, it's iron, but the more it associates with fire, it becomes like fire by association. So in the same way, our impure hearts, if we expose our impure hearts to the association of Krishna, which is manifest in his name, and not only manifest in his name, but Krishna says, Nahim tishtami vaikunte yogi nam hirdiyeshuva tatra tishtami narada yatra gayanti madbhakta. He says to Narada, I'm not in the Vaikuntha planets. Nor am I in the hearts of yogis. If you want to find me, you have to go to that place where my devotees are always chanting my glories. There you'll find me. I always go there. So if we want Krishna, we have to associate with those who make us eager for Krishna. Because it's Krishna who will purify the heart. And those who make us eager for Krishna, for Krishna's pure name. When Lord Chaitanya was discussing with Ramananda Roy, pure devotional service cannot be had by millions of births of pious activities. Pure devotional service can be attained only by those who develops the intense greed to have it. Wherever one sees it, one should immediately purchase it without delay. This was Ramananda Roy in discussion with Lord Chaitanya. Can only be had by those who are greedy for it. And if one sees it, then buy it. Purchase it. But how do you purchase it? Purchase it with your faith. Let me go on hearing. That you could purchase it with your faith. And then the result is you become more and more greedy for Krishna. And Krishna will purify. He's the purifying agent. Krishna, who's in the heart, will purify the heart. The more we become greedy for him. There's no other way. I'm sorry. We should end here. Thank you very much. And we'll Hare Krishna.